No, I'm just kidding. He's the greatest guy.
Kenny Kramer.
I'm just kidding. I'm just, I'm here in New York. Let's be positive.
Okay, let me introduce, well, I'm positive that Kenny Kramer's a piece of shit because he sued you over nothing mm-hmm. and made your life miserable. Mm-hmm. And anybody who makes Fred Stoller's life miserable is a piece of shit.
Mm-hmm.
You don't sue Fred Stoller. He's my friend.
Well, even if you're not, it's all good.
It's all good. Let me introduce Dave Cyrus.
Hi.
Is an award-winning writer for SNL.
I am.
You are. You've written for SNL and Triumph Insult Comic Dog series on Hulu. You're a mm-hmm. great comedian.
Thank you.
You're undefeated in the roast battles.
Correct, yes.
I'm going to help you defeat Pat Dixon.
Someday, yes.
You're also a screenwriter. You're working with
Let's not get into that. I am a screenwriter, but yes, let's not get into the details just yet until Variety releases it.
My Seinfeld year author, Fred Stoller, returns. Hello, old friend.
Hello. Okay.
You have a new memoir about life, death, and stand-up. In the 1980s and the 1990s, HBO's annual Young Comedians special was the ultimate launching pad for emerging comics looking to break into the world of show business. The Young Comedians special produced some of the most recognizable and bankable comedic stars of all time, including Sam Kennison, Bob Saget, Jerry Seinfeld, and Judd Apatow?
He was on a Young Comedian special.
That may not be correct.
I mean, he was on it, but I don't think he was launched. Well, no.
But what about the ones who didn't exactly make it? In 5 Minutes to Kill, actor and comedian Fred Stoller, the Kindle best-selling author of 2012's My Seinfeld Year, tells the story of the Young Comedian special in 1989. He and 5 other talented, then-unknown comics took the stage with the hopes that their 5-minute sets would propel them to fame and fortune. Some, like David Spade and Rob Schneider, hit it big. Others didn't. By turns, hilarious and heart-wrenching, 5 Minutes to Kill is the bittersweet story of what happened to 6 of America's funniest people after their first big breaks. Welcome, Fred Stoller.
And I am one of those 6 funniest. We'll disprove that theory today.
Who was on the 1989 Young Comedians special?
It was, as that copy said, Rob Schneider and David Spade, myself, Warren Thomas, Drake Sather, mm-hmm. and Jan Karam.
Wow. And who hosted?
Dennis Miller.
Ooh.
And it was interesting because it was 1989, as we said, and he wasn't the you know, Bill O'Reilly kind of guy then. He was still, well, you wrote on his HBO show where he wasn't conservative, but I always found it weird. He would say, I want to get these fat cats in his rants. I go, you're a fat cat, you know? But he did some material, like he was putting down, God, I forgot the references from 89, some of them, but he said with abortion, he goes, my theory is, he was against abortion. He goes, no cock, no vote, you know. So he was sort of saying he's against abortion, but he was still being, you know, sort of progressive.
He had a falling out with Warren during that. Do you remember?
I remember during the Young Comedian special. Mm-hmm. I do remember, was it a similarity in material?
Yeah.
And he said, I have a bigger way to fall. You remember that?
Yeah, I remember Dennis telling me that.
Tell me what he said. I didn't put that in.
I just remember that Dennis and Warren were close friends, and then they had a similar bit, and Dennis asked Warren not to do it. And Warren said, you're so rich and successful. Why don't you give me the bit? And he said, I've got
a bigger way to fall.
Bigger way to fall.
I remember Warren telling me that, yes.
Me too.
Now, this Young Comedian special...
Is that in your book?
No, it's great stuff we won't talk about, but it's $1.99 like my son. I'm just kidding.
Let's sell the book, because, as you know, my Seinfeld year was a bestseller because of me.
Right. I thought you were going to say the lawsuit, but...
I had you on my show, and it became a bestseller.
Well...
Because my listeners read.
They do?
They do.
Oh, good, good, good. I have a
while
feeling...
While they're listening to the show, they read because I'm so boring.
I have a feeling maybe there's bigger...
Your listeners are more readers than listeners.
I have a feeling more people read than less than I did Artie Lang's podcast, so...
My listeners read. So, go to Amazon.
Mm-hmm.
If you have a Kindle, order the
Kindle. No. The people get confused. They go, I wish I could read. I don't have a Kindle. But you download a free Kindle app, and you could read it on your computer, your iPad, your iPhone, your laptop, mm-hmm. your desktop. A lot of people go, I wish I could read it. You can read it.
You just need the Kindle app.
Yes, which
it's
is free.
It's a Kindle Single.
Yes.
Is it available on iBooks?
I don't know what iBooks is.
Okay.
So, but if we do an audio, I'm going to have to do David Spade's voice, act out all the characters. That'll be weird.
Well, this is very exciting. Because this is your third Kindle Single.
Second, I had a book. I had first my Seinfeld year, then I had the book, Maybe We'll Have You Back.
Maybe We'll Have You Back. When Life did that come out?
My Seinfeld was 2012. The next year, 2013, was the book, the full-length book, and this is much later, yes.
And how much is 5 minutes to kill?
So $1.99, as I'm going to come up with something no one ever came up with. It's the same price as a latte.
Mm-hmm. No,
you get it? Poor lattes are always like, invest in taxes to say in funds. All right. See, I was funny in 1989, but I got tired.
It's the same price as saving a life in some third world country.
Yes, yes.
Think of all the money you waste. On Save the Children.
Yes.
When you can be... No, this is... God, $1.99.
Well, that's what these Kindle Singles are. It's they're mini books. This is like 84 pages. Their thing is it's more than a magazine article, not quite a book. And they do really well. People like them. Stephen King, all these people have Kindle Singles. So it's hard to get in. But I pitched the idea and... The editor was a fan of these young comedian specials, and I had to...
Oh, so you can't do a Kindle Single without their permission?
You can, but it won't be on their main page. This one is actually not... It's Amazon Publishing, so they have their own publishing department where, you know, they do the cover, and I had to do legal stuff, everyone, and, you know, source everything. Like Rob Schneider was on Cribs and said, this is the house that Sandler built. And I had to show, I had to find the sources, and I couldn't find it. I found it in Russian. They dubbed Rob Schneider in Russian and had to translate it. So I had to source everything and copy it. So it's like real publishing. So anyone in the world can put a Kindle Single out, but it's not curated through their main page of these are the best-selling Kindle Singles, these are the new ones.
I see.
So, yeah. So
and you're indemnified if somebody sues.
Yes, yes. I
now, who's going to sue Fred Stoller?
Who would be that nuts? Who would...
Well, that was on this episode, right? That's, we don't have to pretend that's not...
Oh, we've talked about Kenny Kramer on this episode.
You know, the weird thing is the people you think would get upset about what you wrote didn't, and things you would never think, like, you know, my book, I talked about a one-night stand with Kathy Griffin, and she loved it. Mm-hmm. You know, I think, you know, nothing you say in a book can hurt your career if it's an opinion, like I say things about Larry David.
What happened to the lawsuit with Kenny Kramer?
Oh, it went to the Supreme Court, and then they finally read it and said, Trump is trying to get free speech thrown out, so maybe it'll bring us back. You know,
to make it easier to sue for a
yes.
Slander.
I thought you were going to say to make it easier to sue Fred Stoller. Yeah. They're changing the laws. That was his platform.
But they did throw it out.
Yes. Yeah, he tried to appeal based on the fact his lawyer never saw Seinfeld. I'm not making that up. That was in the appeal.
That he had he picked the wrong law.
Yes. It was like his law, he had bad representation.
Did I ever tell you the moment that I knew or allegedly felt Kenny Kramer is completely full of shit?
The real Kramer.
Well, Kenny, yeah.
Yeah, not Cosby.
It was, I saw an interview with him and they said, well, what do you do for a living? And he goes, I live off the money I made doing comedy in the 80s. And I was like, oh, you're into some shady stuff, aren't you? Because there's no way that's true.
Dave Cyrus. And shady stuff meaning that he has an umbrella.
Look, I'm sorry only that someone would misinterpret what I said to be hurt. So let's go on to positive things.
Let's go back to 1989. You're doing the Young Comedians special. Obviously, we know who David Spade is.
Mm-hmm.
We know who Rob Schneider is.
Mm-hmm.
We know who Dennis Miller is.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about Warren Thomas.
Warren Thomas was from San Francisco, and you were in... I interviewed David Feldman, and he one of your quotes, which isn't in the book, maybe for the DVD extras we'll put some stuff in that got left out. But I asked you, and you said something really profound. I said, was Warren afraid of success? And you said, there's nothing wrong with being afraid of success. I really like that, that it's not a flaw. And basically, I think Dana Carvey and Robin Williams, and you could correct me if I'm wrong, they created this kind of riffing style of free flow in San Francisco, pop references, pop culture, like almost like a... Stephen Pearl was a he was a guy that only a few people could keep up with Robin Williams with riffing. And it was this guy, Stephen Pearl, sweet guy, and Warren Thomas and Greg Proops.
And Kramer, not Kenny Kramer, Jeremy Kramer. did you interview Jeremy Kramer?
No, I didn't get a hold of him. I wish I could have.
And Tom
Kenny.
Would
have been good. Oh,
Tom Kenny.
I love Tom, but I emailed him. He's so busy. He's not just SpongeBob. He's everything. Every second he's doing animation.
By the way, Fred Stoller made history 3 years ago on this show. You're the only person ever to say a bad thing about Tom Kenny.
No.
Do you remember that?
No.
Yes. We were going to have Tom on, and he said he would come on, and I forgot to call him. I love Tom Kenny.
Yeah, I do,
SpongeBob.
Too. Yes.
But you did.
I reached out. It was weird because a lot of people were treating me like I was doing an expose of the Catholic Church and molestation, like, I'm not giving up Spade or Stoller's going in places she shouldn't be. You know, people wouldn't talk to me about Spade. Hey, back off, man. And other people going, I heard you poking around. So some people changed their mind about interviews. It's too emotional. Warren Thomas's best friend said it was going to, then he changed his mind.
Who?
Greg Proops.
Greg Proops didn't want to talk about it.
He did. Yeah. Then he goes, I think this is too emotional, and I respect that.
Right.
You know, he was his best friend. So some people got mad, where I won't say names, where they said, why did you say this? You lied. And I had to send her the tape we did of the interview to go, I didn't say these things.
So tell me about Warren Thomas.
He was, excuse me, a black guy, but... He did.
Just pause there for one second. He was a black guy, but.
But, exactly. But he, yeah, there's the but again. But he didn't really do the Dave Chappelle talking about the plight. Like, he would do stuff like the black guy was, I'm here sweeping. Oh, the lights went out. You know, someone told me in some San Francisco club, he goes, now you can't see me. So he would do the, you know, come in, sorry, I'm late. I'm on Negro time. You know, he would do some, but he
was like Bill Cosby.
Yes.
He didn't make his blackness.
He didn't want to shine a light on the plight. And yes, he wasn't.
He just was, he wanted to be funny. And he was on one side of the divide in the African-American community. One side obviously says, we're black, we're like the Orthodox Jews.
Right.
Nobody's ever going to get over the fact that we're black, so we're going to dress like Orthodox Jews and stay away from everybody else. But Warren was of the O.J. Simpson, Bill Cosby tradition.
But influenced by the Bay, like I said.
And by that, I mean going to prison.
Right, right.
He did go to prison. Warren.
I didn't know that.
Not prison, but he was locked up.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Well, yeah, Al Cleethan said they were both, you know, that joke being black on a sunny day, they would just round them up. He was in the Black Panthers, the junior Black Panthers.
Who was?
Warren Thomas.
Warren
His mother was a Black Panther, and they would have these meetings at Warren's place. So he was brought up with that sensibility, the Berkeley kind of black mm-hmm. guy, you know. But he didn't go that thing, like I said. Actually, I was going to say that like a Franklin Ajayi, but Franklin Ajayi.
Well, he was also a running back, right? Didn't he go to Iowa State?
I don't, maybe, no, you know, I wrote it, but
I got drafted. Oh yeah, to play
and insane. Like John Ross told stories that they would do, you know, mushrooms or whatever all night, acid, then he'd play in these pickup games and score 50 points. His resilience, his constitution was crazy in everything. And no, I remember when I did in 88, Cobb's Comedy Club in the Bay, Warren would headline, he'd do an hour. Then Robin Williams would come up, do an hour. Then they would improv another hour. I'm not making this up. Then when the crowd was leaving, they had no idea who I was because they went up way in the beginning. So, yeah, so he was, like I said, very influenced by Robin Williams, Warren. And the problem with Warren Thomas was he would riff, but he had no discipline. Like, Robin would make it look like it's spontaneous, but he was very, what's the word, not calculated, but he had tricks like a magician and made it look like da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
Planned.
Yeah. Warren never could, he would be insanely funny off stage, and he would never recreate it. Like guys like the late Rich Jenny, you'd hang out with, a comedian, who'd like, that's funny, can I have what you did? And he'd write it down, or if he said something funny. Mm-hmm. Warren wasn't that. Warren could, you know, and the problem,
he was like Rickles. Rickles.
But he still is like a Robin Williams, where you know the shtick he's going to do. Hey, here's this guy in the front.
Well, Rickles, if you go back and watch Rickles on Carson, he truly was in the moment and saying things off the top of his head.
Right.
There's no way, because he's not telling jokes. You're saying that Warren
Was pure.
He'd go on stage and
he would still riff. Like I wrote about in the single, the book, is that after his set, like David Spade went, you were kind of like, he would just, what did you do? Because were you lost? Because he would kind of go, what else should we talk about? Yeah. And stumble. And they had to edit it to make it, because he goes, yeah, I like to just find my way. So to him, it was almost not cowardly, but not, yeah, to be, maybe just wearing a pussy, but and just have a 5-minute structured set that you rehearsed.
Right, I think he.
And even for an HBO special, he was not riffing. He had some signature bits, like he did the first black guy to fly first class.
I'd like some more peanuts, please.
Yes.
And Dick in the Butter Tray.
I remember that.
And he had some signature bits, but what I found out from interviewing him is he would like to lose the crowd, piss them off, almost call someone a C word, and then get them back. And he almost, part of his act was, he did a bit where he'd go, where did Warren lose him? And he would take the mic like a pointer and go, well, he did the Dick in the Butter Tray, and he would try to remember, you know what I mean? He almost on purpose, right. Like I did when I did stand up, a lot of my jokes were bombing, like I'm having fun. This reminds me of the night I got stabbed in the head, you know, just weird. And then I would try to do them when I was doing well. Oh, that doesn't make sense. So Warren, part of his thing was losing them on purpose almost. Does that, you remember?
Oh, absolutely. That?
That
was a San Francisco treat.
Oh, really? Yeah. So Warren was, he was on, but not in an always riffing, but, and you said something interesting when I interviewed you, that you were in the Bay, and you couldn't riff, but you would like for sport to argue, and you would almost take turns like saying, I think Bush is good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We would drive to gigs and fight as a joke.
Well, you know, I love Warren. I don't want to give things away, which I just did. But he got to a point where he loved to argue and contradict you, where I did a real assholish thing. Like one time, I said, oh, that's so sad with Christopher Reeve. He goes, what's the big deal? People get paralyzed every day. Fuck, he's a celebrity. So then as an experiment, I went the opposite way. Like the next day I go, you know, what's the big deal with Christopher Reeve? Why they herald him? He goes, well, he's a spokesperson. They need a person to raise money, and we need to raise him up. You know, so, you know what I'm saying? He liked So I would, like an asshole, like say the opposite of what he argued with me about on another day.
You know what I remember he did that just made me laugh so hard? Jon Ross was best friends with him.
Yes. Jon gave me such great insight.
Jon is such a great storyteller. One of the things that made me laugh the hardest was I went to pick up Warren. He was staying with his mom right next door to Berkeley. It wasn't Oakland. It was Can't remember the name of the town. Anyway.
San Francisco.
Yes, thank you. That's right. No, it's the town over.
Concord.
No. Can I just say this guy's too muscular to be funny? It's bothering me, but let's talk. Oh, sorry.
So
you have a low threshold for muscular.
He and his brothers used to do this to his mother. She'd be serving them breakfast, and they'd go, "That's it, bitch. That's it, bitch. Crack the egg over the skillet. That's it. You love it. You love me. And they would, and she would be laughing.
Oh, he's from the Joe Rogan School of Comedy. I'm just kidding. Just kidding.
All right, Warren Thomas.
Drake Sather. Yes. This guy was...
I loved him.
You remember him?
Yeah.
Oh, great, great, great jokes. This guy was like... I'm interviewing Rob Schneider for this. They were really good
friends.
You
did interview Rob Schneider?
I did.
Yeah.
And he was really cool.
They were roommates in San Francisco.
Yes. Right? And Drake was like a heartthrob. And they were into like fashion, those guys. Like, well, he wrote Zoolander. And he was really, Drake Sather, into those kind of GQ magazines, into metrosexual, you know, fashion. Really,
well, he's a
loved
very
it.
Good looking guy.
Oh, stunning. Yes. Right. I interviewed a woman who dated him and Rob Schneider, and she, you know, Bernadette Luckett, sweet lady. You dated her too.
No, I love Bernadette.
Yeah. So she said, she was just describing his appeal. I looked into his blue eyes. I felt I was swimming in them, how gorgeous he was. But he was really into image and. He was into Andy Warhol. He was, someone said, this guy, Mark Brazil, who was, I interviewed, was very articulate.
That 70s show comedian.
Yes, he created that 70s show. And he said Drake was almost like, or maybe Rupshin, I said, like Andy Warhol, like he dyed his hair jet black and doing this kind of persona, almost performance art, where his first wife was a stripper. And they went on People's Court, and they did it together as performance art. It was brilliant, almost like with Judge Wapner. And
did they know? Did Wapner know it was performance?
No.
Oh, that's genius.
So he was like almost a performance artist in his own way. And he, when he said to Rob Schneider the first time they met her, he goes, "You want to meet my wife? Okay." And they go to a strip club, and she's dancing. So he was really into. Man, who's that filmmaker who the eye gets slashed? I don't know.
Dolly.
Yes, he was into that. He was into Lenny Bruce.
Right. So it wasn't Dolly.
There was the slash in the eye?
No.
When they made it a hard-boiled egg?
No, it's the
that's David Salvador
Bowie.
Dolly.
I can't remember.
No, that's Salvador. That's Salvador Dolly's like first film where there's a woman. They used a hard-boiled egg to make it look like they slashed an
eye
open. Yes. I swear to God, that's Salvador Dali.
All right.
And
Bowie used to play it.
But that was
years later. Yeah. He loved that he was with a stripper because Lenny Bruce's had a stripper wife or girlfriend. So,
honey.
Yeah. So Drake really was into that stuff. And he was so cool because he never spoke. He was like, for a while, I would... His wife, Marnie, he met in Australia, beautiful. Do you remember Marnie? She was a waitress at the Laugh Factory. And I'd hang out with them. And he had this coolness, so not neurotic. You know, one thing I put in the book, like he sidles up to me, you know, and he goes, you know, before the taping, he goes, "Me and you, we have it tougher because we're tall. We already won. So short, scrappy guys that make it." That's why the resentment.
Well, what does
this
say? Say this again.
He said, "Me and you, we have it tougher because... we're tall. We already won." He was sort of intuating that the short, little scrappy guys go far because they are overcompensating. Like, I won the genetic lottery because I'm tall.
Oh, that's interesting.
Which I didn't. He was tall and gorgeous, you know, and all that. Funny story. This woman slept with Drake. And then I don't want to disparage the dead, but this guy passed away, this comedian who... he did jokes. He looked like Super Mario or whatever. And he goes, "Why'd you sleep with Drake and not me? Come on, babe." And he was pulling her. And the joke, which is not joke, is how do you go, "Hey, it's like me talking to a woman. You were Brad Pitt. Why him and not me?" All right. That's interesting.
Was this a San Francisco comic?
Yes.
Bald?
Yes.
Heavy set?
Yes.
Criminal record?
Yes.
Stephen Allen Green?
Yeah, Stephen. You know Stephen Allen Green?
I'm very close to Stephen.
You know, I don't want to
tell a lot of stories.
I don't want to say. All right, this will get
back. No, say whatever you want.
I know Stephen Allen Green. He did a rant on Facebook how everyone's fucking him over, and me and Norm Macdonald did something to him. I don't remember something. We talked. We maybe talked about him on this podcast, and then. I just was I'm a lonely guy, and I go, hey, who wants to get a milkshake on Facebook? And he was the only one that bit.
Now, do you know that Norm Macdonald shared an office
with Drake? That's in my Kindle Single. And Dennis, their first writing job was the first Dennis Miller show, which you seem a young guy, but to know your stuff.
Yeah, I was a fan of the Dennis Miller show, yeah.
But I'm talking about Tribune.
Before HBO.
Yeah, like how Jon Stewart had a show.
Yeah, the network show, yeah.
Yes, I think it was Fox, but so Norm got fired, and it's like the Seinfeld bit, he kept coming to work.
Norm got fired?
Yes, right away. And then he just kept coming in with them. Says, all right, give him the job back. Norm would just write one joke a day, but it would be a great joke. He'd say, well, I have to write these. You know,
he shared an office with Drake.
And Norm called them the twins because they were both tall, brilliant, and quiet.
And Dennis was obsessed with their office because the lights were always off. And he goes, the heart of darkness.
Ah!
What's going on?
Were you on that staff?
No.
That was Drake's first writing job. Norm's, Mark Brazil, who ended up... they tell the story. Mark Brazil did really well creating that 70s show. And if you follow him on Facebook, he's very liberal and very passionate. And his heart was broken. Norm always tells a story. You know, when they're starting the show, he goes to... Dennis goes, we got to go after this Rush Limbaugh guy. And Dennis goes, I kind of like that cat. And then Mark's face drops and he sulks away. You know, I kind of like the things he says. You know, so, yeah. So who else was, you know, Kevin Rooney I interviewed.
Kevin Rooney was the head writer.
He was on staff. Yes. Right. So what was your first writing job on Dennis's show?
It was on Roseanne with Norm. And one of my... One of the reasons I got fired was because of Drake's Aether.
Why is that?
Well, I was getting shut down in the room. And Drake was working on Larry Sanders. And Larry Sanders
Yes, the Radford lot. I'd always see him walking around.
So I would run into Drake, and he goes, how's it going? Because it was my first writing job.
And I go, was Fromstein on with you?
Yeah, Ray Fromstein. Yeah.
Yes. He's in my book. Stevie, I love you. And... I know you're... No, there was a story with Stevie, and he was only concerned. That's why he wasn't trying to throw me, but I'll tell you later.
So Drake gave me this advice. He says, how's it going today? And I said, it's a nightmare. I've got this guy running the room who just keeps shutting me down, and I'm so much funnier than he is. And Drake said, what you do is, this was 20-some-odd years ago, go for a walk. Just leave the room and go for a walk, and then come back, and you'll be refreshed. You'll clear your head. So we went for a walk. Drake and I went for a walk. It was a 4-hour walk.
4 hours.
I came back. My days were numbered.
Well, with me, when I wrote on Seinfeld that year, I remember there was no table on Seinfeld. You know, you were on your own, everyone for themselves. And then it got to a point where 6 weeks to go in this... He said, I'm not going to do your episode. It's Larry Dave impression. He goes, no point in starting anything else up. So he didn't say, but you know, just stay home. So I'd come in every day just for lunch, go for walks, play pinball, and run throughs. But he said, don't do anything. So that was Larry David.
Drake said there, and then he... passed away.
Oh, you're giving away the endings, but well, I guess it's self-explanatory.
Well, there's more to it than that, but
yeah,
right. Yeah, in a way that.
Well, let them read and find out what
is
happened.
Is that in the book?
No. I it starts with the Young Comedian Special, then it ends. I'm just kidding. I follow them all through every. Okay. Yeah.
Jan Karam.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful Jan.
Yeah,
Karam.
I write about her. I think she was a precursor to the hot chicks doing comedy. I mean, I won't name names. She knew a writer on Saturday Night Live or a producer. And said, hey, could I be on? He goes, you're too beautiful. And then finally she said, well, what about Tina Fey? And that's, so she, a precursor to the Sarah Silverman, Amy Schumer, hot chicks. Or Jen never owned her hotness. She never, you know, talked about, you know, bodily functions with semen and, you know, I'm not saying that's all they do, but you know what I'm saying?
I right, laugh she didn't talk about sex.
No, she was like girly, but she was really beautiful, and she still is. So, you know,
remember Vanda Michaels?
Yes.
Just thought I'd bring her up.
Yeah, she was more like a vampy kind of, well, Vanda Vamp. No, she was, yes, she was a very sexy lady. Mm-hmm. But yeah, but women in the 80s were more like kind of like mini Paul Reisers, you know, the, you know, punch, punch, you know.
Paul Reiser was punch, punch?
We think
that 80s kind of New York, roll up your sleeves and...
Paul Reiser?
Yeah.
I think he means Paula Poundstone.
Yeah.
No, sorry.
I don't know.
Go ahead.
I think it's odd that, like, we think of it as such an advantage to be a beautiful woman in comedy, but at the same time, I think Sarah Silverman might have been one of the most attractive women who ever lived, and she never got a movie. And she was amazing.
She's got movies.
She never starred in a movie at the peak of her hotness.
Well, I'll tell you about... No, this is what I think about Sarah Silverman. Very, very, very attractive. But she's attractive where she makes you think one of us could be with her, even though we never could. You know what I'm saying?
No,
she has an accessibility.
I don't believe she has an accessibility.
Like, what's her name? Who's that woman? The black lady, and whose line is it anyway? Aisha Tyler is gorgeous, but it's not an accessibility. Like, there's a wall up. Sarah...
What makes you think you could have Sarah Silverman?
Nothing in the world. But she... You know what I'm talking about? An accessibility.
You feel like if you make her laugh, you get the impression if you make her laugh enough, she'll love you. Even though you're not going to make her laugh and be gorgeous.
Just accessibility. What's her name? The whose line is it, lady? There's a wall. She's not... to me. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. There's a... not a flirty with Sarah Silverman, but like... like Amy Schumer. Yeah. So Jan was a precursor to beautiful women being comedians, but mm-hmm. she never really made it like those people did.
Okay. Well, this is exciting.
Yes. And I interviewed you, wow, this is so long ago, on Mother's Day, and you only gave me a few minutes because you were in your car. You were in Jersey. But
was this last year?
Yeah. I think it was Mother's Day.
So that would be like a year ago.
Yeah. It took a while.
And what did I say? Did I give you any insight?
Yeah. I like the thing about what's wrong with being afraid of success.
We talked about that earlier in the show.
Well, that's about all the insight you gave me. I'm trying to, you know, pump you up, but
I was talking to Mark Normand about fear of success, waiting in the wings to go on and saying to yourself, wow, this is too much pressure. I can't handle it. And fear of success, I think, is a rational response to realizing the pressures that success is going to bring you.
Well, in interviewing for this book, a lot of things I didn't realize. I didn't realize the Bay in the 80s was, I thought only New York City's comedy boom in the 80s was where there was more gigs than comedians, where you could almost effortlessly make a living. I didn't know in the Bay they were like rock stars.
We were rock stars.
And like Bob Rubin, and some of them were in a comfort zone where they were, you know, like almost raced to the rafters, and where it was hard because in the Bay, they were these rock stars. Then they had to come to Los Angeles, to Hollywood, and figure out how to package that to showbiz, to package what was special about you. And it wasn't about being creative as it was in the Bay. It was more like, and a lot of them couldn't do that. Like Warren, you know.
But some of them could.
Yes.
The tension in San Francisco, and that's over, by the way. There's no, they don't encourage young comedians in San Francisco.
Really?
No, it stopped. But at the time, in the 80s, early 90s, you were taught to be a star. You had a following.
In San Francisco?
Yeah. You were encouraged to develop a following. Kind of like now with social media.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you had to be funny. And then you had to have a following.
Like Bob Rubin.
Yes. And you had to nurture your following. And you're right. Then you'd go to New York and L.A. and you'd have your ass handed to you because nobody knew who you were. And you weren't getting free laughs. But some people, like Ellen.
She was from the Bay?
Yeah. Well, originally from New Orleans. But right. she made her name in the Bay Area. And Whoopi made her name in the Bay Area. And Dana Carvey. And Jake, and I'm thinking a lot of, and then they moved to LA and they had their first round of star making in San Francisco. It was kind of like the minor
leagues.
Well,
Dana Carvey was, yeah.
So they knew how to do it.
Right.
Others came down and couldn't apply.
Or there was some that a great guy who I just met a few years ago, Jeff Bolt, who was on a Young Comedian special.
Was he on your Young Comedian?
No.
Yeah, very funny guy.
But he was on an earlier one, and he was
hysterical.
He was making like $50,000 a year doing some advertising voiceovers, and he had a kid, and he goes, "Why do I have to go to to Hollywood?" So there were people that never came to Hollywood from the Bay.
They didn't need to, because at the time, Wall Street had not bought up all the local radio and television stations and advertising agencies. Nobody realizes it. I think they're beginning to realize that Wall Street has just sucked all the commerce into the tip of Manhattan.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, all these. There was one guy.
There was a time when I lived in San Francisco and all the radio stations, all the advertising agencies, all the television stations were locally owned, and the newspapers were locally owned. So there was real competition. There was real money.
Plus, in the Bay, a lot of these guys were big stars on this radio show, Alex Bennett.
Alex Bennett, yeah.
He was like a Stern kind of guy. So they were in such a cushy, yeah, their followings, they'd go on Alex Bennett.
I was on the Alex Bennett show, and yeah, I mean, I would be recognized.
Wow.
It was weird.
So what was it like when you first came to Hollywood or did you go to New York after?
I went to Hollywood,
mm-hmm.
But I went as a writer, as a stand-up. I had been doing stand-up for about 12 years, and I got as good as I was going to get.
What year are we talking?
94.
You were getting TV spots around then, right?
I was doing a lot of cable access shows. There was all like MTV and A&E, but I couldn't break through to like HBO. I couldn't get on.
You did a one-night stand, though, did you?
I don't. No. I did Comedy Central Presents.
I was going to say, I know I saw you on TV in the 90s.
Yeah, yeah. I was on TV a lot in the 90s, but it was all the low-rent TV, and I was told not to do it. I was told to save myself for The Tonight Show. And I said, these are the only people who are putting me on TV. Mm-hmm. I decided I'm going to do every TV show and get so comfortable on TV that
it was hard to turn down evening at the Improv.
Right. Yeah.
And the truth is, I mean, as someone who was watching stand-up as a kid in that time, I don't remember who I saw on The Tonight Show and who I saw on evening at the Improv.
But you know something? I'm not sure if you want to tell your age, but when I tell people about my book, many people 30 or younger had no idea what these HBO Young Comedian specials were. Or evening at the Improv. I sound like an old guy. People don't know their history, but you would think if you're a comedian, you'd want to see people starting out on these Evening at the Improv. So those old kind of, you know, if you could find them.
Don't judge my age by my face.
Okay.
Judge it by the fact that I can't sit here without a heating pad and not be in intense pain.
Well, because of all the Nautilus.
How deep are we into the show? I want to say something about being Jewish. How deep are we into this show?
Almost 40 minutes.
Okay. And then we had Mark Norman on. You know, what's your last name?
Stoller.
What's your last name?
Cyrus.
Okay. What's my last name?
Feldman.
Who's got the Jewish last name?
You.
Okay. I got to carry the weight for my entire religion. We had Mark Normand, right, in here, mm-hmm. talking about how he loves the Jews. He's not a Jew. He wishes he was a Jew. And you walk in, Dave Cyrus walks in, the Jew,
uh-huh.
with the Persian last name.
And now I feel wrong. I shouldn't complain. Now I'm hot, Alex. Can I have some AC, please?
Yeah, this is what I'm talking about.
Yes.
I got to act like the Gentile. I have to act like the guy from Connecticut because my last name is Feldman. Cyrus walks in the middle of the show with Ben Gay, reeking of Ben Gay, three pillows.
Yep. Heating pad.
That was
my great grandmother's.
I can't move my neck.
Yes.
And this little part of me is thinking, shh, not in front of the Gentile. Then I run into Fred Stoller.
I might as well have told him how much
I really do have a cold.
But hang on. I run into Fred Stoller as we're saying goodbye to Mark Normand. The first thing out of your mouth is, I can't shake your hand. I got a cold.
I'm being nice.
Where can I get the chicken soup? Where can I get chicken soup? Don't get block. Too close to me. And then you walk into the studio. It's so drafty in here. And I have a, and by the way, I have a problem with your friend. I won't mention the name, but you start bringing up the friend. And I'm thinking, I don't get to act that way.
Well, let me
hang
tell
on
you
for 1 second. I don't get to act that way because my last name is Feldman. I would love to walk into the studio
let me
and
see.
Complain, but I can't.
No, let
you
me.
You guys have your Gentile last names, and you get to be Jews.
The very idea that you think you'd pass for a second with a Gentile last name.
Let me say my defense, my act, my persona was never like a Kindler, like, oh, the Jews here on your territory. I've worked with Kindler, and he mocks me when I was on Marc Maron, like, oh, the annoying Nebbish show, you know, like Kindler. I really don't reference being Jewish. I don't go, oh, yeah, I was a skinny guy. They hit me. I'm Jewish. That's me, Kindler. But no. But you know what I'm saying? Kindler is so
but
Jewish.
But you guys walk into a room and Jew it up.
No, I'm neurotic in a different way. Like my mother. When I talk about my mother,
Pearl?
They go, yes. They go, she's a typical Jewish neurotic woman. No, she's some other pathology. It's not that, and I think I'm neurotic, but it's not the Jewish cliche. I'm not saying Kindler's cliche. I can't think of other, you know what I'm saying? I'm not the Jewish, like Jackie Mason. Oi, I'm not voting for Trump. He doesn't like Israel. Oh, that's my impression of a Jew.
His parents, Pearl and Morris.
Mm-hmm.
Pearl and Morris. You deserve...
That is pretty Jewish, yeah.
Yeah, you deserve an anglicized last name if your mother and father
are Jews
Pearl
hated
and Morris.
I grew up in Sheepshead Bay in Brooklyn.
Me too.
Really?
Sheepshead Bay on Bragg Street.
Brown Street.
Wow.
Right by the Bell Parkway.
Yeah.
And I didn't know Jews were a minority. We had no education because I'd see menorahs everywhere. And they never liked us because we weren't observant Jews. So don't play with Freddie. He eats kumits. And and they would always be racist, small-minded. But 2 days a year, they dress up. And I never liked that hypocrisy. Like, we're good Jews. And you guys are. So we had a house fire. The house, not burnt to the ground, but burnt.
Your house fired?
We had a house fire when I was.
Yeah. Your house caught on fire?
Yes. Electric fire.
Did you have menorahs?
No. An electric fire.
You know, you always hear about Christmas tree fires.
Never
hear about
menorah
fires.
So the rabbi says to us, now maybe you should go to temple and start praying. And my father goes, no, everyone else on the block should pray and thank God it wasn't them. And so I always...
You tell him, Morris.
I never liked this exclusivity, like... Every word is us against them, the Goyim, the Schwitzes, the Schwatzes. So I don't go, oh, we're persecuted. I'm the Jew here. The only time I ever ran into anti-Semitism was in San Antonio at a comedy club. They screamed out, where'd you get your nose job, Jew? And so, no, I'm not like when it's going, oh, we're persecuted.
That's the town motto of San Antonio.
Yeah.
Where'd you get your nose job too? But man, I talked about Kindler on Marc Maron. You know what I should do, Alex? Maybe we should call Tom Sharpling and resolve my feud with Kindler. I'm pitching Tom Sharpling ideas on your podcast.
Who do you feud with lately? Because you do have feuds. A lot of people think of you as a nebbish, but you have a lot of rage inside of you.
Well, people think they could bully me because, you know, I have this persona. So I don't know. When people bully me, I push back.
What about when Norm bullies you?
I figured something about Norm MacDonald. People think he's drunk. He slurs. You know what I think it is? He will tell you things off stage. But he's very diplomatic. He'll be like, yeah, that guy's great. Who? Yeah. So I think he's very smart where he doesn't, he's not like me, like a schmuck, says things. Kindler goes, yeah, Kindler's great. He goes, Kindler, does that make sense?
So you travel with Norm?
Not anymore.
Did you have a falling out?
No, but...
What was the name of your cat who passed away?
Mitchell.
Because of you, I've come up with a theory about cats. How old was Mitchell?
Lived to be 18.
Wow.
And you loved Mitchell.
I don't hate to say it. That's the best, closest relationship I ever had with anything. Parents, except for Alex. I'm doing shtick, you know, like I'm being so lame. I'm making fun of Kindler.
Is it all right if I ask you about Mitchell? Because I don't
sure.
want to upset
he's
you.
Been he's been gone about 2 years or maybe more.
Where did you find Mitchell?
Well, when I wrote on Seinfeld, there was the Radford lot. So in the days when Larry said, don't bother doing anything, but I wanted to show up to get my last six checks, I'd go for walks. And do you remember there was a place across, I played pinball. Do you remember there was like a weird shack kind of thing? And then there was a place called Rusty's that had pet adoption. So, and I never had cats growing up. I never got them. I thought they were like squirrels. But then a cat showed up at my place and was rolling on his back. I didn't know cats could be great, but then
What do you mean he showed up at your place?
He would just, like, maybe he was lost or a neighborhood cat. I'd open the door, he'd come in, roll on his back.
This is Mitchell?
No, it was another cat. I go, I didn't know cats were amazing like this cat. And I said, but then the cat stopped showing up. Maybe either was lost or whatever.
Maybe he was on to you.
Yeah. So then I said, I think I want to get a cat because when I wrote on Seinfeld, I saved the money to get off the road. I hated the road and said, I want to stay in town now and try to be a character actor. So I said, I remember the place Rusty's and they had Foster Days. And and everyone's sitting there with their cat and I didn't know which one to pick, you know, and one woman, actually, I looked her up and her name, she was a Playboy. She was in Apocalypse Now as one of the Playboy playmates.
Oh, right, yeah.
She was, I forgot, Cindy Woods. I wish I could email her and say thank you for the best 18 years of my life.
Best pussy I ever got.
Yes.
I did it. I went for the pussy.
Yes. So she goes, this one is so exceptional. I'm thinking of keeping him. So I trusted her and he would leap into my arms to be held, kissing me. And now I'm an insane cat lover. I'm staying with Rena, who has two cats.
Was he named Mitchell when you got him or did you name him Mitchell?
Well, if you read my Kindle Single, I'm not saying that. When I, you're going to mock, but when I came to, I went through a thing when I auditioned for the first 1989, Young Comedian Special. Rodney goes, you're too low key, okay? And I went through a funk and, I remember I went with this comedian, a guy, Mike Egan, a great guy. You probably never heard of him.
Sounds familiar.
He just was a New York Philly guy. And he had a 13-year-old son who was so in, you know, from a past marriage. And, Dad, are you going to be on that cable? But it was public access. And it hit me. If you have a kid, you don't come home, I'm a piece of shit, Rodney doesn't want me. I don't know how you or your kids. You have to hold it in and your kid's excited for any little victory you have. So then I had an imaginary son, and his name was Mitchell. And when I moved to L.A., Mitchell would be proud of me, and this is very...
What do you mean? Like, was he a real imaginary son?
Well, I wasn't that psychotic where I'd give him cereal, you know, and wipe his face and put him on the toilet. Well, you don't do that with 13-year-olds. But I came up with the inner child concept before they did it. I wasn't that pathological where...
But you did have an imaginary son.
Yes, named Mitchell. Wow. And then my cat was called Mitchell.
But were you doing it as a joke or did you actually talk to an imaginary son?
No, it wasn't that psychotic where I would talk to him in the street. But I remember, you know, just when I did the Tonight Show, I remember thinking, my son's proud of me. I had to do this so I didn't beat myself. Like my mother would come home, it's almost over. You know, my mother never understood about being strong for your children. I'm going to die. Who's going to go first? Me or Morris? Morris, make sure you like it. It's your last car. What if Morris goes, I don't know how to do things. So I didn't know that.
If your mother and father were named Pearl and Morris, you're going to move to Sweden. And marry the first blonde.
Yeah. I really wish now that Triumph's dad was named Morris and not Sydney, because that's so much more
so,
Jewish.
Matt,
you know, now you know what I did with my kids. This is true.
Did you come home, I'm a piece of shit? My jokes didn't get used today? Or no?
Well, no, I always come home and say, Fred Stoller's a piece of shit. No, this is true. I had an imaginary son and an imaginary daughter, because my daughter...
You didn't like...
Was terrible.
Yeah. No, my daughter had an imaginary friend.
Get out of here. You're not mocking me.
No, I swear to God this is true. My daughter had an imaginary friend, and I thought it was really cute. So my daughter was like 3 at the time. I said, well, I have an imaginary daughter. Her name is Donna. And
wow.
So Donna would come in, and we would... And then Donna became perfect.
So then, had to live up to it.
So I'd go, Donna doesn't have a temper tantrum. And I did it as such a joke that my daughter, by the time she was seven, was getting...
Stop comparing me to Donna.
Yeah, she would get a knife and stab
Donna.
And then my son had, you know, imaginary friends. So I had an imaginary son named Don. So there was Don and Donna.
You know what I remember about
hang
your son?
Hang on for 1 second. So... as the years went on and my kids became more depraved.
More depressed.
They would be in the back seat talking about Don and Donna. It got to the point where they invented a storyline with their friends where Don had impregnated Donna.
Oh, my God.
And Donna had to go. I go, where's Donna? Now they're like 16 and 18. Yeah. Oh, Donna went away, Dad. Can't.
Maybe it's good I never had real kids.
they and their friends had this whole scenario where Don...
Just the idea
the daughter
that
you
taught your kids to believe that their imaginary friend had a miscarriage. Fantastic.
It was pretty funny. What were you going to say about my son?
What I remember is I used to bump into you a lot...
at the farmer's market.
But also, walking in the grove, Pan Pacific Park, and I think you were, he was playing Little League, you were his coach, here's Freddie, you go fart for him, and he did. Like, did you teach him to do that for people?
No, he was always loaded.
And you would just tell him to do it.
Yeah, he had this gift.
Gift.
Then he discovered girls. He hung out with comedy writers and comedians. And he would come up to the... wherever.
That doesn't seem like a David Feldman sensibility.
He would come in from the time he was like 6 months old, he would crawl into a writing room, find the candy, and then by the time he was three, he could go, look, everybody, I can fart. And he would make a fist with both hands, you know, and he'd fart and everybody...
Is he doing stand-up now and headlining and you open for him with that?
Well, his name as a stand-up was Frankie Lane.
Really?
I made up this imaginary...
See, I feel not so crazy. He's saying this.
I used to tell everybody that he was Frankie Lane, America's youngest political satirist. This is when he was 8 years old. So I used to crack Jeff Garlin up. He'd go, what's going on? I can't play with you, Jeff. I'm taking Frankie Lane out to the improv. He's auditioning for The Tonight Show.
See, the thing is, you made this out of loneliness. He had kids to take care of, but he's making these things up.
Or just to not beat myself up so much, to be strong and have someone be proud of me and all that stuff.
I'm sorry, his name was Ralphie Lane. I apologize. Ralphie Lane.
Oh, thank you.
Not Frankie Lane.
I was confused.
Frankie Lane was a singer. There on the 101 near Monterey, as we would head up to San Francisco to visit Grandma and Grandpa, there'd be a road called Ralphie Lane on the 101 heading north. And I always thought that's a great name for a stand-up. And then I would turn to my son and say, he was like six at the time, you're Ralphie Lane, America's youngest political satirist.
Wow, that's great.
It became this running fiction.
I mean, it's too bad you didn't go all the way and do what a lot of dads did, which was just feed their nine-year-olds all their failed stand-up bits because it works when a child doesn't. I mean, you've seen that. That's how Amanda Bynes started her career.
I did not know you did a thing called Feldo the Clown, someone just told me, where you did your same act as dressed as a clown. Did you know this?
Yes, we've talked about
that. I didn't know that.
It's his email.
Right.
I didn't put it together
that you, I didn't think, oh, he literally was a clown. So
yeah, I wore a clown suit for a while.
No.
But like, it works for your act, though, because your act is just so
dark, depressing
and dark that having just like a failed clown do it is really funny.
The hardest I ever made Warren Thomas laugh, we were working a club and I was in a clown suit, drinking, drunk, and fighting with my then girlfriend, soon to be my ex-wife.
Soon to be my ex-wife.
And we're going, and I'm in a clown suit. And then I turn to Warren holding a shot of Jack Daniels. I go, I can't control this woman. And he just started cracking up because I'm this unshaven clown, bozo fright wig, red nose, holding a shot of Jack Daniels, totally unaware that I'm in the clown suit complaining about my girlfriend. He just, anyway.
There's so many stories of Warren and one of the things, he was always on, but he was generous, meaning he made you funnier. He wasn't like a guy with a wall up just doing shtick. He really brought you along and went with your bits.
Warren could do two. I'll shut up. But there are two things that I remember. One was Dana Carvey, and one was Warren Thomas. This is how funny these two guys are. I remember watching on Saturday Night Live, Carcinio.
Yeah. Yes. Sure.
Dana Carvey as Carcinio.
Yeah, it was great.
And I started laughing so hard in a way that I had never laughed before. And I remember thinking, oh, this must be what it feels like to be a woman being entered. I swear to God, that was, I had this reaction where I was going, oh my God, this must be, like, he was that, the comedy was so invasive.
Once someone I interviewed for this said Warren was like almost a killer.
Yes.
Like he was an assassin.
Yes.
Like he'd see you laughing and then he'd go more and more, like right up to your face. He wanted you to like almost like
Warren
kill
would,
you.
Warren, that I was going to say about Warren, that was Dana on TV. Dana could do it to strangers on TV.
Yes.
You know, Dennis says, and maybe it's true that Dana was the best ever to do Saturday Night Live. He may be.
That's a great point, yeah.
And so what Warren would do is he would riff in your face.
Yes.
And you would drop to your knees.
Yes.
And he would stand over you.
Yup, keep going.
Riffing, and you'd be curled up.
Yes.
Laughing.
And like, you know, an assassin.
Like, yeah, an assassin. You know, Robin, you know, Robin wouldn't do that.
Pearl Proops.
Proops wouldn't do that. But Warren would stand over you. And you'd just go down. You would walk into a room and there'd be somebody down laughing.
Yes.
He would take you down.
But again, the sad part is he couldn't translate that to, you know.
That's why I brought up Dana first, because
yes,
Dana can.
Yes. He couldn't translate that to where America could see that and, you know, all that stuff. But I was good to, I guess that's what it's like being a good host. I got out of my head. Talking to people, made friends, made some not friends. One guy, I won't say his name, was like my Kenny Banya episode. You know the Seinfeld one?
Yeah, of course.
That happened to me. Real guy Bruce Smirnoff gave me an Armani suit and demanded a meal for it.
Well, hang on for 1 second. Bruce Smirnoff is our Miami bureau chief now.
Oh. So in real life... Well,
tell us about Bruce Smirnoff.
He gave you... your story. He gave you the
what happened was there used to be a place... The Beverly Connection and a Starbucks. And
sure.
And one time I saw him. He goes, what size suit are you? I don't know. I didn't ever have a suit. He goes, I'm muscular. I've been working out. He goes, I got a new Armani suit. Doesn't fit me. I'll give it to you. And all right. An Armani suit. He would said it was $1,000. I don't want to get into another lawsuit, but I found it for someone. It was on the closeout rack for $200. You know, he goes, you take me for a meal. You know, the story really happened. So we went to Jerry's Deli. And Jerry's Deli...
Hang on for 1 second. If you listen to last week's show...
Yes.
Bruce Smirnoff is on. He references the episode.
Wow. Yes.
And we talk about Jerry's Deli.
Yes.
Go ahead.
So he, you know, he says, I'm just going to have the soup, save the meal. He got soup and a soda. Came for like $20. So then he'd call me up. He'd go, I'm at Jerry's. Want to meet me? So he'd have the soup and soda, skip saving the meal. And...
Fucking crazy.
I pitched it to Larry.
He's crazy.
He goes, Jerry's more assertive. He would say the first time soup doesn't count. So what happened was then, I wrote the episode off it. And then I got, it wasn't asked back to Seinfeld. And then Bruce goes, I want a real meal, not just Jerry's. Because, you know, you made money. You wrote an episode. So I took it to the Palms. And everything.
Wait,
I didn't
did
know.
You already pay for two soups at Jerry's at this point?
But he said he goes.
Oh, he wouldn't let you pay for them.
No, I paid for them. But his contention was, you made more money because you wrote an episode. You made money. I gave you also gloves and a scarf.
Oh my god!
He goes, I don't want. Oh. He goes, Jerry's you gave me, but because finally we had a Jerry's meal. But he goes. I want like a real meal, like, and I'm such a nebbish. I go, let me just get this over with. I know, just get it over, whatever. I can't say no. So I had just got fired from Seinfeld, and he's sitting there like, it was on, I can't think of an example, the late Brad Gray, like on Paramount, where I never went to a restaurant like this. Everything's a la carte, and he's wiping his hands. I get a coffee. I'll get soup and a and he's oh, and I'm sitting there with my head down. I hardly had anything. Then he's getting a dessert, and you know. So he went to town. Oh, so in doing this research for this Kindle Single thing, one comic, I don't know if he'd have the sense of humor as Bruce would about it, but he, you know, he was in the scene. So we met at a place in Malibu called Nobo. It's expensive.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
What's it called? Nobu. So he goes, I'll take it easy.
Is that sushi? Sushi?
He said, I'll take it easy. I'll just have appetizers. It came to $70. So then he goes, I just thought of other information. So we meet in for waffles, you know? So then I pay, you know, again. So then.
Who are you having this?
I'll tell you off, maybe, because.
You're doing this as research for Seinfeld.
No. This.
For his book.
This was for the recent book. When
oh,
I see. Okay. I didn't mind. I paid for every. One for the, you know, I pick up their meal because they're giving me information. And three of them were very menschy. They go, Freddie and Freddie, I'm not letting you because they're multimillionaires. Rick Messina, Mark Brazil, and Dave Rath. So go, you're not picking
Dave
this
Rath
up.
Is a multimillionaire?
Well, he manages so many people. Pete Holmes, and I can't think of the list, but I don't know. He's does well, yes.
Good.
Yes, yes, very
he
good
took
guy.
Care of Warren.
Yes, yes, yes.
He was very, when Warren got sick, he was instrumental in maintaining Warren's health.
Very generous and with me. So this other guy texted someone that led to an interview for my book. He goes, no, I want a real meal at Nobo's, not just the appetizers. I go, you're just like
Who
Kenny Banya.
Who talks this way?
I go, you're just like Kenny Banya. He goes, you benefited, I should benefit.
Wow.
So then I kind of been estranged from him because other annoying things. So I
now, do you keep up with Bruce Smirnoff?
No, because he's in Florida, and I see he's a Trump supporter.
Is he a Trump?
Maybe he's not. I don't know.
You got to cut him out of your life.
Yeah, because hey, I would see on Facebook.
He's so funny.
He is very funny.
Right? Isn't he one of the funniest people? I mean, yeah. Isn't he the great storyteller of all time?
Yes, he is. He did that one man show, and he. Just his cadence, like, I got a nose job. You know why? Pussy! you know, just like he just, even though it's that old school cadence, it's, I'm not going to go there, you know? Yeah.
We all know that comic, and I could see how they could be a Trump supporter, that comic who nickel and dimes everything, and not even like money-wise, that like, Patton Oswalt tells a great story in his book about how he was featuring for some comic, and the comic had like a fit because the clock radio in the features room had more features than the clock radio in the headliners room. And he switched them and then left him like a page written out in hand about how the reason why he needed to do this.
Hmm. Well, when I worked with Tom Kenny, who, you know, he's making up that we had a fight, but went on an animation show we did.
No, you came on the show about 3 years ago and you were pissed off at Tom Kenny because...
Oh, he would always say, I'm a working man. I'm like Woody Guthrie, and he'd come an hour late to every session and charm everyone. I envied him because he's charming. No, he's a great guy. I was just
he's
stupid.
Of course he's a great guy, but nobody in the history of the world ever said a bad word about Tom Kenny.
I didn't say
except for
bad.
You.
So he'd always say, you can't be right-wing and funny, and I disagree.
Who said that,
Tom Kenny? But I disagree
good for him.
Because this is why I disagree, even though I'm not right-wing. Is comedy's based on fear, and I was once watching boxing, which I'm not into, with these very successful comedy writers, and one of them, it was so sickening, goes, the black guys, they have everything, they have the big dicks, and they get the women, and they beat us up, and it's, so a lot of people, it's fear-based, and like, oh, you know what I mean, so a lot of comedians are fear-based, and fear is, they're going to take us, things are going to, you know what I mean, so that's why I think you, a lot of the right wing, tenets is fear. And it's like, oh, you know what I mean? Does that make sense what
yeah,
I'm saying?
I agree yeah. with you.
Like,
I
let's say
hate. I think that hate is what makes comedy so funny. And who's more hateful than a Trump supporter?
Or they're fear based. You know,
I mean,
like
Trump is funny.
I disagree.
No, but
Trump is pretty funny.
But well, you know what I'm saying? Their fear of they're going to get us, you know, they're going to take our stuff. They're going to beat us up, you know, like Gilbert would do bits like, oh, a Jew and a black guy in an elevator, and the black guy gets off. You know what I mean? I'm scared. It's a Jew. You never hear that. So it's funny, but it's more like based on that kind of fear of them taking our money, beating us up. You know
what
I mean?
You started with Gilbert. What was he like when he started out?
Probably the least likely guy you think would be married with two kids. Wow. But
and the most beautiful wife, mm-hmm. and the most beautiful kids.
Did you know him before he started doing the voice?
Yeah, he...
Oh, he didn't have that voice originally?
No, he was... He would annihilate a room where I couldn't go up. I go, I'm just doing stupid jokes. He would do... He did stuff. The most, you know, he was on the Gene Domanian Saturday Night Live because he would just do, it was almost, I almost think maybe SCTV ripped it off because like Humphrey Bogart is Woody Allen in this. Well, SCTV did that stuff. And Gilbert would do Jerry Seinfeld talking to David Brehm or Gavin McLeod talking to Tony, who's that guy? Jamie Lee Curtis, Tony Curtis. How you doing, Gavin? How you doing, Tony? Or Woody Allen as taxi driver. So he did brilliant, annihilated, you know what I mean? I'm not too good with thesaurus, but brilliant a lot. But then he became that guy in acting, screaming. You know, when I did stand-up, I was pathologically shy. And my persona, because of who I was, my head would be down, and I'd make nooses with the mic stand because I couldn't look at them. That became my character for a while.
Was it real or a put-on?
It was real. I was pathologically shy and depressed.
Go ahead.
So Gilbert, I think, can't look at the audience. And closing his eyes and waving his arms, you know. So I think it came out of.
I will
really
tell
connect.
You, as long as we're talking about bodily functions,
mm-hmm.
okay? Alex Brazell, no relation to Mark Brazell,
mm-hmm.
took me to see Gilbert at Caroline's about a year ago.
Uh huh.
And I didn't know how funny Gilbert was going to be live.
I had the same thing.
Exactly.
Right? I, as a kid, I knew him as the guy from Problem Child. I knew him as this character actor you see all the time. And you see a stand-up, like, oh my God. You thought he was just going to do like a, you know, just a cheap character version. He's a fucking genius.
He would depress me, actually. Not that I was envious, but I go, what am I doing? Like, yeah. It was, yes. And
so
he's
hang on for one second. So I just want to share this because it's irrelevant and self-indulgent. At one point, I started to laugh so hard. Remember, I said, Dana,
yeah,
this is what it feels like to be entered. Every orifice opened up. I thought, oh, my God, I almost shit myself. Thank God I'm regular and I take care of myself and I'm a vegetarian because I would have just emptied everything into my... pants. That's
yeah.
I never understood what they meant by, oh, I laughed so hard I shit myself until I saw Gilbert Gottfried.
Yeah. I was like that as a kid with Jenny.
Rich Jenny.
Yeah.
I was
12, 13.
He was a genius. Rich
you
Jenny
know something?
Was a genius. It was 10 years ago.
Rich Jenny
we lost
was
10 years ago.
Amazing, but there's this faction that thought he was hacky, you know.
I don't get that at all.
I don't either. Yeah.
I'll tell you what close your computer, please.
I was just seeing what time it is.
The faction with Jenny, they were the purists who didn't like Robin, in that Jenny knew how to take a premise that was kind of in the ether and then get every piece of meat off the bone on a premise
unbelievable.
That appeared to be kind of generic. But that was his genius. He was accessible, not hacky.
No.
I used to open for Rich. I was very close to him. And
I once slept over. I was locked out of my house in Brooklyn. I lived there. And in Canarsie or somewhere. Yeah,
he was a kind, kind man. So brilliant. So funny. And very anal. He was just, I would write with him. And he didn't do a volume business. He would fixate and just keep fixing
things.
Well,
I said he was the polar opposite of Warren Thomas. Well, Warren would be riffing and you think, write down what you just said, do that on stage.
Right.
What did I say? Rich would do things like, if you're not using, I don't mean stealing, but like,
right.
Can I do something with that? I could put
right.
that.
He was a shark when it came
yes,
to material.
Yes, a shark, yes.
He was he was an amazing writer, and to the point where like you would catch him, if you really knew his act, you would catch him slipping written things into like interviews, which a lot of people did. But like you could just see like this, that's where he was comfortable. He was comfortable saying things that he knew he mm-hmm. was ready for.
Bruce Smirnoff has the greatest story about his wake that I have to ask him to tell next week.
Okay. Tell Bruce, you know, thank you.
Does he know? He knows about the suit. Does he ask for another meal?
Does he know about
Bruce Smirnoff knows about the Seinfeld episode.
I brought him into audition for Kenny Banya. I thought, give him a shot. And he came in. And the problem sometimes is that Larry David wasn't looking for a Bruce Smirnoff. The guy who got it was great, Steve Heitner. He goes, I didn't get to be me. Someone else was better being me than me. An Irish guy with muscles. But
how could Larry not love Bruce Smirnoff?
Because I think he was trying too hard to Bruce up his Bruce-ness when we weren't look. We again, I keep saying we.
But
when
Bruce
they weren't
is,
looking for
Bruce,
Seinfeld.
Bruce is one of the funniest people
yes,
in the world. Right?
But as you know, some of the funniest people don't translate to acting.
What about his one-man show?
Great.
The funniest, right?
Yeah. The thing with the Nazis and he had to follow a Nazi propaganda.
Did you have a falling out with Bruce?
No. Why are you saying that?
I don't know. I just want to make sure.
No, I'm going with your thing about how funny his one-man show was.
Mm-hmm.
No. I think when Steve Heitner auditioned for Banya, he wasn't going, I studied Bruce Smirnoff. He brought this annoying, you know Kenny Banya
sure.
character was
yeah.
pretty good what Steve
they
Heitner did.
Brought him back a lot, yeah.
Yeah, so they weren't looking for Bruce Smirnoff, is what I'm saying, even though it was based on him. Larry loved what Steve Heitner brought to it.
It was a very like consummate Seinfeld character, the way he did Banya.
Right.
You know, there's that Seinfeld was one of those shows that just had such a recognizable tone that he really did hit that I could see how, you know, they just.
Right. Bruce Smirnoff was the. It's like if Andy Kindler, who's funny, even though what I'm saying, I'm just being stupid, but Kindler's funny, but, you know, that is not as a definitive Seinfeld, you know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah.
Persona. So
you're back in New York for how long?
Till Friday.
When'd you get here?
Crazy late Saturday night. The plane was delayed 4 hours, and I got here Saturday and just.
Did you see Pearl?
No, she's in Florida.
Good for her.
We're in Florida.
Coconut Creek. Do you know where that is?
I don't know why I know Coconut Creek. Oh,
it's near Fort Lauderdale.
There's definitely a wrestler who, as a child, was introduced as being from Coconut Creek, Florida. That's the only
yeah,
reason I...
If you're lucky, we get to go to 2J's. It's a Jewish deli place.
You go down and visit her?
I'm due, let's just say. Not as much as you would think I would, but from all this stuff. But I'm due. I had to do this trip. Actually, I got a new cat. So when I told
what's his name?
I got a cat that was already named, so I'm keeping it as Luna. She's funny. I like
Luna.
At first, I unfairly compared her to Mitchell, not the imaginary son, but the Mitchell the cat. And now I've fallen in love, and I'm very fortunate because I got a great cat sitter who's staying at my place.
Do you think it's healthy for humans to give human names to cats? I don't. I think you give a cat like a name like Bingo.
I actually agree with that. I named my cat Angela because yeah. I was mad that my friend named his dog Stacy, and I thought that would somehow get back at him.
Oh,
and I'm
I
an idiot because it was he's like, oh, that's cute, Angela, and I'm like, well, that was a complete waste of time.
The ultimate revenge.
Yeah. My ex-wife is the kindest person in the world. She's the
an animal lover. You have a lot of animals.
Yeah, except to me, she's the kindest person. Her one vice was we would name an animal. And she would give it a horrible nickname that was abusive. We had a cat that was named Ginger, and the cat was fat, and we would call it Fatty. We had a dog named Ugly, Stinky. She was kind to all animals, is kind to all animals.
Except for that way. Well, I dated this woman who would say she had six cats, and she goes, I know Swati is F-A-T. Go the cat. You don't have to spell fat. The cat doesn't know. Right. And even if it did, you know what I mean? If it could spell. Oh,
this
man.
This is relaxing, isn't it?
Yes, David.
We're going to wrap it up.
Yes, yes.
It's time to go.
Well, this guy, you're real cool. At first, I was nervous.
Oh, thank you.
You know, but I'm not just saying this, but I didn't know you did the Triumph writing. Some of the best writing.
Yes, it is.
Some of the.
Yeah. No, well, I love
it. I didn't follow. No, I used to see Triumph on. Obviously, Conan. Did he do always that laughing like he's cracking up before Who? He even does Triumph? Like it seems that's is that a new thing?
That's not a put on. That's because a lot of times he hasn't read it until he's about to say it.
Really?
No, that's not a put on.
Oh, I thought that was part of his persona.
Not at all. I've seen it because I
love it.
Can I real quick just say one of the happiest moments of my life? And this is you have to understand right after getting fired from SNL, so I'm in a very vulnerable state, and it's my first day on set with Triumph where I actually see the dog.
And I'm gonna guess you felt so good that you cracked Robert Smigel up.
Well, it's not. Well, yes, but yes, the joke is, it's the way that like I'm watching him like a hawk, and he's starting to do the shtick, and I see him reading through the paper, and he just stops and starts laughing to himself, and then collects himself and does. And then I hear it's the first time I'm hearing one of my jokes.
But isn't
out
that
of his mouth.
A brilliant happy accident that it looks like it's something he's deliberately doing for the, you know what I'm saying, like Chris Christie, you know, Chris Christie. Look at the weight scale.
It's because there's so many writers that he may have read it once and forgot about it. Mm-hmm. And then he's reading it for the first time. And it was a joke we didn't even use. It was in the whole journalist.
See,
thing.
Now it's a negative for me because I thought it was a brilliant tick he came up with, contrived.
No, he's just unprofessional.
That's great what you guys have done.
I miss Black Wolf.
Oh, what a great guy. What an interesting man. Wait, what do you mean miss him? Is he dead?
Well, we haven't done a show in a while. I miss Black Wolf.
You worried me. I was like, what happened?
Well,
all right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Oh, what's the name? I ripped up your intro. Let me plug your. This was a lot of fun. It's great
Thank
to see
you. Thank you so much.
It's like being back in L.A.
Yeah, back in
without time. Stephen Alan Green.
I'm going to see George Calfa tomorrow. I used to bump into him when
Tell
I walk
him
around.
I said
with,
hello.
And Bill Rutkowski. I don't know if you know that.
What's Calfa doing?
You know, he's so
we'll
happy.
Talk, we'll talk afterwards.
He's so happy to be out of the madness.
Yeah, he was a sweet man. He still is. Hey, my Seinfeld year author, Fred Stoller, has a new book. It's a Kindle single. It's all about his young comedian special and his special friends. So pick it up on Kindle. It's called 5 Minutes to
Kill. Pick it up on Amazon.
Pick it up on Amazon. Pick it up, 5 Minutes to Kill. It's $1.99. I mean, you could blow that kind of money on
Uber.
A kid. In
an imaginary son.
You know, or in the, you know, so spend the money on
Thank
this
you
book.
So much.
Thank you. Dave Cyrus, how do people follow you on Twitter?
Oh, you go to Dave Cyrus, that's like virus, S-I-R-U-S, and or just, you know, YouTube Brickstone if you want to just see a bunch of other crap I've done.
I've never that. Talked about that.
Yeah, it's not a big deal.
We should talk about that.
Someday.
Thank you, guys.
Very fun.